The next major incident that is narrated in the Sirah is the first immigration to Abyssinia. When these tactics of open intimidation, of humiliation, of torture continued, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam eventually suggested to the Sahaba that this land has become too constricted for you. Why don't you emigrate to the neighboring land of Abyssinia? For there is a Christian king there who is a just king, and he shall allow you to worship without interfering in your worship. And this announcement was made in Rajab, in the fifth year of the da'wah. So the third year of the da'wah, he goes public. Less than a year and a half later, we will not understand what hardships this would mean to emigrate to a new land. The people there are not of your tribe, and you are second, third class. You don't have any izzah. You can be plundered, raped, looted. Anything could happen. Nobody's going to protect you. On top of that, you don't have bank transfers. You're not going to take your wealth and then, you know, wire it to the different land. No. Your property is your property. You can't sell it at market price because you're not telling anybody you're leaving. To make matters worse, they have been told to go to a land where you're not even speaking Arabic. It's a different culture. It's a land in Africa. And therefore, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave this command, 15 people immigrated, 11 men and 4 women. Why were all of these from the noblemen of the Quraysh? Because the slaves didn't have the political luxury to emigrate. SubhanAllah, if you think about it, the people who needed to immigrate the most couldn't do so. Umm Salama narrated, first person, it's in Bukhari. Umm Salama said, so we began to live in a good land with good neighbors, and we were safe with regards to our religion and did not fear any persecution. And the Prophet ﷺ said, this is interesting, he is a just king because he does not persecute his subjects and he does not interfere in their religion. Shortly after the immigration to Abyssinia, the Muslims returned back to Mecca. In fact, so much so that it is narrated that they came back within 3 months. Why would they return just after 3 months? What happened that caused them to change their minds after emigrating to Abyssinia and then come back to the very land of persecution, the very land of torture? They returned back because of one rumor. And that rumor was, the Quraysh have accepted Islam. No matter how wild the rumor sounded, their hearts were yearning to go back. And they didn't have the connections that we do with the modern facilities to verify. So they pack their bags and they come back all the way back. And on the way there, they discover that this is in fact not true. What is the basis of this rumor? And it says in this hadith in Sahih Bukhari that in the month of Ramadan, 2 months after the Muslims have immigrated, the Prophet ﷺ recited Surah An-Najm. And Surah An-Najm is a very powerful surah, very eloquent surah.
النجم إذا هوى ما ضل صاحبكم وما غوى وما ينطق عن الهوى إن هو إلا وحي.
And when he came to the very end of the surah, the very last verse in the surah basically says, فَاسْجُدُوا لِلَّهِ وَاعْبُدُوا, that prostrate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and worship Him. And so the momentum built up in the surah and the excitement built up and the power of the Quran affected the entire congregation, Muslim and non-Muslim, such that when the Prophet ﷺ said, فَاسْجُدُوا لِلَّهِ وَاعْبُدُوا, the Muslims fell into sajda. And when the Muslims fell into sajda, the Quraysh were so overwhelmed with emotion, they too fell into sajda. Muslim and non-Muslim, for the first time, they all united behind the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The rumor begins a hand span and it returns back an arm's length. By the time it reached Abyssinia, the rumor had become what? They've all accepted Islam, they've united behind the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this rumor, as we said, led to the Muslims to return back from Abyssinia, and they, when they came back, they discovered that this rumor was false. So the point being that the situation in Mecca remained status quo. It didn't change at all. And the Quraysh continued to persecute the Muslims. And so the initial batch that had immigrated from Abyssinia came together and decided, what do we do now? And the bulk of them said, let's go back. But in the meantime, they had stayed in Mecca 2-3 weeks, and the news spread amongst all of the Muslims about how good life was in Abyssinia, at least in terms of physical harm. Yes, it was difficult culturally and language and climate, but not hostile. And so when they heard this, a large percentage of Muslims, we don't know how many Muslims were in Mecca at the time, there were no censuses, but it is probably correct to say that at least 30-40% of the Muslims of Mecca, if not 50%, decided to immigrate. Now that's a huge number. And so for the second immigration, more than 80 Muslims emigrated. And this time they were headed by Ja'far ibn Abi Talib, the direct, obviously, cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now, when over 80 people, and Mecca at this time probably had only a few hundred people in it, right? So 80 people in Mecca represents more than 15%, 20% of the people of Mecca. And it's a big embarrassment that your own people are leaving. And this is the Quraysh, the one that is the strongest tribe, the most elite, the most protective, the custodians of the Haram. And now they have 10-15% of their own tribes people emigrate. This is a shame. Now the Quraysh decided, we cannot allow this emigration, we need to stop it. They decided to send two people to Abyssinia and appeal directly to the Najashi. Najashi is the title of the person who rules Abyssinia. So they sent two delegates, Amr ibn al-As and another person. Scholars have differed who that second person was. So they traveled all the way to Abyssinia. Umm Salama narrated, when we landed in Abyssinia, this is the second hijrah, we were treated very hospitably by the Negus. He granted us security in our religion. He allowed us to worship Allah without persecution or any hindrance. In fact, we did not even hear one ridicule against us by the people. But then the Quraysh heard of our status, that we have Izzah. And so they plotted against us, and they decided to send two strong men. By strong, she meant people who would do their job, not physically strong. The two strong men. And they gave them precious gifts. They loaded them with gifts. And the two dignitaries, emissaries, arrived in Abyssinia. The first thing that they did was they went to all of the viziers, the ministers of Najashi. And they gave each of them expensive gifts and leather. Basically bribed them. And they said to them that we have in your midst a group of renegades and rebels. And we will speak to the Najashi tomorrow about their case. And we want you to hand them back to us and support us in this cause. So basically this is open bribery. When we give the Negus his gifts, remember our gifts to you. Because they're going to bribe the Negus tomorrow. And subhanAllah, look at the hatred really of the Quraysh here, that they can't even bear to see the Muslims live in a foreign land. So the next day they approached the Negus and they said, some foolish youth from amongst our nation have emigrated to your country. They have left our religion and they have not embraced your religion. They've invented a new religion. And the leaders of our community have sent us to you in order that you hand these young foolish people back to us so that we can deal with them, because we are more knowledgeable of their faults than anybody else. And so they presented the Negus with lots of fine gifts. So when they finished their petition, the vizier stood up. They've been bribed. And they said, O our ruler, verily what they have said makes complete sense. These are strangers in our land. We don't know anything about them. Return them back to their people. Let them deal with their affairs. Najashi said, no, by Allah, I cannot just hand them back after they have chosen my land. Now remember, when they entered Abyssinia, even though the books don't mention this, but it must have happened, they must have sent a petition to Najashi asking permission to live. So he said, these people have chosen me over all the other lands they could have chosen. And they ask for my protection. The least that I can do is to listen to their side of the story. So the Nika sent a messenger. Najashi sent a messenger to Ja'far ibn Abi Talib. And he said, come all of you to the palace tomorrow and explain to us why your people are opposed to you. Now, they had never seen the Najashi. Najashi is the king, right? And so they became frightened, which is only natural. And they said, what are we going to say? And so Ja'far said, we will only say what our Prophet ﷺ told us to say, and we're not going to change the truth no matter what happens. I will speak the truth. So when they arrived at the palace, they found the Negus surrounded by his advisors. So he was surrounded by the viziers and the patriarchs. This is an official meeting. And you have Amr ibn al-As and you have his companion on one side, and you have Ja'far ibn Abi Talib and the delegation of the Muslims on the other side. Now, Amr ibn al-As entered first, and him and his companion, as was the custom of the Najashi, they prostrated in front of him. Ja'far ibn Abi Talib entered, and he walked in erect, firm, and he did not lower his head one inch. The minister said, how dare you walk in without prostrating to the Najashi? And so Ja'far says, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us that we can only prostrate to our Lord. And so Najashi says, tell me, what is this religion of yours that you have now invented? And what is the matter that you have forsaken the religion of your people and you haven't embraced my religion, nor have you embraced the other religions on earth? So Ja'far responds, then, your Highness, we used to be a nation steeped in Jahiliyyah, and we would worship idols, and we would eat this dead meat. You know, if an animal dies, we'll eat it. And we used to perform fahisha, and we would break the ties of kinship and treat our neighbors in contempt. The strong amongst us would eat up and devour the weak. And we remained in this state until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a messenger to us. This messenger was known to us. He's from our community. We know his house and his lineage, and we know his truthfulness, and he never spoke one lie in his life. And he invited us to believe in one God alone and to leave idol worship. And he told us to abandon the ways of our forefathers that are and to leave the worship of stones and statues. And he commanded us to be true when we speak, and to fulfill our promises, and to fulfill the ties of kinship. He told us to be good to our neighbors, and he commanded us to avoid all evils. He told us to not spill blood, to give true testimony. He forbade us from eating the property of orphans. He forbade us from accusing others of adultery. And he commanded us to worship Allah alone without associating anything with him. He told us to pray and to fast and to give charity. So we believed in him, and we followed him, and we had faith in him. And we worshiped Allah alone, and we gave up worshiping idols. And we forbade upon ourselves everything that he told us to forbade. And we made permissible all that he allowed for us. But our people opposed us, and they showed hatred towards us, and they tortured us, and they punished us, and they tried to force us back into idol worship. And they were unjust to us, and they made life miserable, and they prevented us from being who we were. So when they did this, we emigrated to your land, and we chose you above all other rulers, and we wish to come under your generosity and hospitality, and we put our trust in you that we would not be shown injustice in your land, O Exalted Highness. And so this speech swayed Najashi, and it moved him. And he said to the Muslims, do you have any revelation that this Prophet says he has? So Ja'far said, yes, I do. And so he said, recite it for me. And so Ja'far ibn Abi Talib recited the beginning few pages of Surah Maryam.
Kafha ya ayn sad. Dhikru rahmati rabbika.
And obviously it is said, Ibn Ishaq himself says this, that even the patriarchs, without even understanding what was being recited, they were moved to tears. And the Najashi himself began to cry. When it was translated to him, he too began to cry. He said, I swear by God, this recitation, this tilawa, and the messages of Moses and Jesus have sprung forth from the same fountain. This is the same source. And he spoke to the two emissaries and said, go away from me, because I'm not going to hand these people over to you. So Amr ibn al-As and his companion exited in humiliation. And as they were leaving, Amr whispered over to his companion and said, don't give up yet. I have one final trick. His companion was the more gentle of the two. And his companion said, leave it, Ya Amr. Because look, even if we don't agree with him, in the end, they are our relatives. But this is Amr ibn al-As, and at this time he's not a Muslim. So Amr said that no, one more attempt, just wait tomorrow. So the next day, they sought permission again. And the Niga said, what do you want? We already decided. And so Amr said that, oh, Holy Emperor, we forgot to mention to you one thing, that they say something blasphemous about the God that you worship, Jesus Christ. So Najashi sent the emissary again on the next day and said, come immediately to the palace. Come immediately to the palace. We're waiting for you now. We want to know what your position is on Jesus Christ. At this, the Sahaba were struck with terror much more than they were on the day before. Because now this is like, come right now. And so once again, they say, what are we going to say, Ya Ja'far? And so Ja'far said, we will say exactly as what the Prophet ﷺ told us to say. And we will not change this for them. And so they come back to the Najashi, and Najashi is a bit irritated. And he asks them, what is this that I have heard that you have a blasphemous opinion about Jesus Christ? So Ja'far said, Your Royal Highness, we say exactly what our Prophet said. Now notice he said this phrase multiple times. So the point being, he says, our Prophet told us that Jesus Christ is the Abd and the Rasul, and the Abdullah and Rasulullah and Kalimatullah, that he gave to Maryam, Al-Batul Al-Adhra, the virgin, the innocent, the chaste Maryam, and that he was a righteous prophet. And so when Ja'far said the truth, now it comes out, and we can read into the lines here, that the Negus was not in fact a believer in the Trinity. And he didn't believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And so he picks up a little branch that was in front of him, a twig, and he says, Wallahi, what you have just said does not exceed what Jesus Christ said by this much of a branch. And he turns to the emissaries and he says to Amr ibn al-As, that be gone from here and take all of your gifts back with you. I have no need for them. And so Umm Salama is narrating all of this, and she concludes by saying, the two emissaries left humiliated, debased, and degraded. And we remained in the land receiving the best hospitality and the most neighborly treatment for 14 years. 7 years after the Hijrah, the Muslims were still in Abyssinia. Only after the Battle of Khaybar, and that's in the 7th year of the Hijrah, did the Prophet ﷺ send them a letter and tell them to come back. The Prophet ﷺ wrote Najashi a letter and he invited him to Islam. And Najashi wrote back to the Prophet ﷺ saying that, I am a Muslim and I believe in you and I believe in all that you say. And if you command me, Ya Rasulullah, I will come right now to Medina and serve you. Najashi eventually died a number of years later. And the Prophet ﷺ came out one day in Medina and he said, Jibreel has come and informed me that a pious brother of yours has died in a neighboring land. Before anybody could come and tell him, 2 weeks journey, instantaneously, on that very minute, the Prophet ﷺ was informed that Najashi has died. And he commanded the Sahaba to come and pray the one and only prayer that was ever prayed in the life of the Prophet ﷺ, Salat al-Janazah al-Ghaib. The only time ever in the history of Islam that the Prophet ﷺ prayed over somebody without a body being present.